Let's start. So hi, everybody. So our next speaker is Jorgas Papathanasiou from DESI. He's going to tell us about integrable limits of scattering amplitudes.
Thank you very much also for the invitation. Greetings from Hamburg. It's a pleasure to be presenting here at IGST. And I certainly hope that I will have the chance to visit São Paulo again sometime in the future. So my original plan today was to talk about two recent publications with two wonderful sets of collaborators. One about the Reggie limit of scattering amplitudes, one about the origin limit of scattering amplitudes, where integrability, as appears in the title, emerges. In the process, I realized it would be too much for a half an hour talk. So in the end, it was a very tough choice. And in fact, I prepared two talks, but I will focus mostly on one of those two limits, the origin limit. So mostly my recent work with Benjamin Basso and Lance Dixon, who may also be in the audience. And it also relates to some previous work with different subsets of collaborators. So let's go. Let's start with my motivating question. What keeps me going and keeps me excited every morning that I wake up, even in this coronavirus period? The question of whether we can understand and describe the S-matrix of gauge theory, even beyond Feynman diagrams. So, of course, the S-matrix was considered to be, at sometimes in the 60s, a fundamental object that everything should derive from it. But irrespective of the philosophical aspects, what is the primary and what is the derived quantity, certainly the elements of the S-matrix, the scattering amplitudes, are some of the most central objects in quantum field theory, and where they allow QFT to make contact with experiments. The absolute value squares are the cross-sections that is precisely what we measure in collider experiments. So computing scattering amplitudes efficiently is necessary in practice in order to be able to make contact with the experimental results. And this relates to also doing perturbation theory, but in a more efficient manner. And beyond also perturbation theory, aspects that have to do with exactly non-perturbative aspects of quantum field theory are very, very important, both physically and mathematically, as indicated in one of the Millennium Prize problems, which is related to non-perturbative aspects of gauge theories. So, of course, these are very nice questions, very exciting questions, and very hard ones, no doubt. So my strategy is to focus on the simplest interacting gauge theory, and this is maximal supersymmetric on, or n equals 4 super Young Mills. And in fact, I will be focusing also on the simplest limit of the theory, namely when we take the number of colors to infinity while keeping the toothed coupling fixed. Of course, this theory is at the heart of many of us here attending this conference, because together with its string theory dual, it has a remarkably integrable structure. And it allows to compute physical quantities exactly in the toothed coupling that I define over here. In fact, exactly, this structure gave birth to this series of conferences in the whole field of research. And in this conference, I think all of us can appreciate, and I can put this already in the second slide, an example of an exact physical quantity that has arisen through the heroic effort of many of the researchers of the field, namely the CASP anomalous dimensions, gathering the anomalous dimensions of operators with very large spin, that can be written in just two lines. This particular physical quantity is just related to a semi-infinite dimensional matrix. This is just the usual geometric series of this matrix. And then this matrix is the so-called BES kernel in a particular representation that contains Bessel functions, and there you explicitly see the function of the coupling. So this I think is a great development that has come out of this field, and it's inspiring and motivating, and it definitely places hope in being able to describe exactly other quantities. So my question, or my what I will try to talk about today, is whether we can make similar progress also with amplitudes. And other quantities are also possible, and we also heard from Grisha's talk, but this will be the main topic of my talk, where of course these developments have been shown in the past that they have practical applications. We start with a very, very symmetric theory. In the end, we can boil down applications even for QCD and for the standard model. So what is the present and future of solving the simplest gauge theory? And by this, I mean scattering amplitudes in this talk. So it's a very good thing, that it's very encouraging that already for 4 and 5 particles, we know amplitudes to all loops. And more generally, so for 6 or more particles, this is the landscape that we have, and this is the possible tools that we have at our disposal. So let me try to describe this graph. On here on the left axis, we have the tooth coupling, lambda or G. So if we are here on this horizontal, near this horizontal axis, we are in perturbation theory, coupling is small. And in principle here, we can do perturbation, yes, Feynman diagrams. However, in the past years, a very powerful technique called the amplitude bootstrap has allowed to go to very high loop orders in computing amplitudes without even having to look at Feynman diagrams, just relying on the analytic structure. Then on this axis over here, we have string theory. N equals 4 has a string dual, and this gives us access to the leading strong coupling order. And here on the left, this has to do with the axis that I label here by T. So the other axis, the horizontal axis, has to do with how general or how special our kinematic configuration is. So if you think of it, yes, schematically on the right of this graph, we have general kinematics. And when we take this parameter t to 0, let's say an angle between two scattered particles, we take it to 0, then we end on some special limits. And for scattering amplitudes, it's only on these limits, only on this special kinematic region, such as the collinear or the Matulaeri limit, that we now understand currently integrability, and we can make all loop statements. So in the past more or less 6 or 7 years, my research has been focusing on pushing the boundaries of these regions and probing more and more of the dynamical, the amplitude content of the theory. And today, the main topic of my talk will be to put another kinematic limit on this map, to describe a new limit called the origin that I will define, where particularly for the 6-particle amplitude, we can make progress and describe it at finite coupling. So this is the main goal. And if time permits, I will also talk about the multi-regi limit, where we have also been able to make progress for any number of particles and describe also scattering amplitudes, yes, for any multiplicity there. So, but the hope is by doing this, by pushing these boundaries more and more, in the end, we will be able to really seize the all loop S matrix of the theory, both at any coupling and also in general kinematics. That's a general philosophy. So this is the outline of my talk now that I've presented the main feature. After some brief introduction, I will talk about the observations that led us to get excited about this origin limit. Then I will connect to the integrable structure that appears there. I will move on to describe the main results, the finite coupling expression for the amplitude in this limit and the checks we did before concluding. So let's start. The six-particle amplitude in a particular Hellenistic configuration, so the so-called MHV, as we discussed, is the simplest non-trivial case. And it has been known some time now to have remarkable properties, namely, most notably, is duality to Wilson loops. Wilson loops are different observables, non-local ones, but nevertheless, the kinematics of the scattering amplitude turn out to dictate the contour in which we integrate the gauge field defining the Wilson loop. This can be seen by passing to these dual space variables. And so we are constructing a null polygon. This was seen first at strong coupling due to the beautiful world of Aldair and Maldacena, and then also realized it holds generically also at weak coupling, this duality with Wilson loops, by the ANSI, Jesparis, and also the Queen Mary group. And this duality also implies that the amplitude has a dual conformal symmetry, a symmetry which is the normal symmetry of the Wilson loop, having to do with transformations of these dual x variables, which nevertheless is invisible at the level of the amplitudes. And after we factor out by universal infrared divergent piece, the so-called BDS or BDS-like ansatz, it won't be important for our purposes because it's very well known. What is left, so this is the object I will be focusing on today, is indeed a function that is invariant, say, under rescalings or under conformal inversions of these dual variables. And as you can see also from this picture, it can only depend on three cross ratios, the one depicted here, so that, yes, it's projectively invariant, and also the cyclic permutations thereof, and shows you this picture also why it's not possible to have something non-trivial for fewer points. If you had 5 points, then we could only form cross ratios with these light-like segments, and this would give zero or infinity. So this is the main object we will be focusing on. And while it's not the topic of this talk, we can compute this amplitude, both at 6 and 7 particles, very, very efficiently, as I mentioned with the amplitude bootstrap method. And I should say, yes, this was started by Dixon, Drummond, and Hem a long time ago, but it has proceeded to unprecedented loop order. And I can recommend also this very recent review with most of the players in this game. That appeared recently, and it's very accessible, describing how exactly this method works. But the point is that once we have the 6 or 7 particle amplitude, now I'm focusing on 6, in general kinematics, even at fixed order in the couple, it's natural to scan the space of kinematics and see if some pattern emerges. That's what we like to do as physicists. And here, this is the limit I will be focusing on. I told you already there are 3 cross ratios, and I will consider the limit where all of them go to zero. And so it's origin in the sense that it's in the space of independent variables of cross ratios. This is the cross ratio I had in the previous slide, and it's evident that we can make it zero by turning one of the Mandelstam invariants in the numerator, a 2-particle Mandelstam invariant, to zero. So this is, as you see, the origin is in a sense like a triple collinear limit, somewhat, not quite, but as you can see in this picture. So this is the limit we will be focusing on. And let's see what we first discovered in this perturbative setting, what we noticed in this limit. So by taking the results that with my collaborators we obtained up to 7 loops for the 6-particle amplitude, we noticed that in this limit, it takes a very, very interesting form. So it's the form that I have in this equation. We didn't write it exactly like this, but what we did notice, and that's what's important for this in the first instance, is that it has exponentiated double logs. So it has a Sudakov-like behavior in this limit. And then this is the only kinematic dependence, and there are two numbers that then parameterize and where, the, say, loop order, where the coupling dependence enters. And we particularly looked at how these coefficients look. So they only had, for example, this one, yes, only pi's or only Riemann zeta values. But then we realized that it's an expansion of an exact function in the coupling, and a particular exact function that had already appeared before. And we heard very interesting talks by Grisha and Tiago and also Ivan yesterday in this conference. So the same quantity appear in the simplest four-point correlator or the octagon operator squared in a particular limit of large R charge. And also when you take the kinematic variables, the two cross ratios of this correlator to be light-like, precisely the same quantity. Not only we see this quantity has finite coupling description. It matches the perturbative expansion matches a null-loop quantity, but it has also appeared before. So it was very natural for us once we noticed this to scratch our heads and ask, is there any connection? And okay, we saw this particular coefficient in this limit. How about this anomalous dimension here? How about this number? How about this constant? So this was then what we set out to do. And as I mentioned before, it would be great, and it is a holy grail for me to understand how to describe amplitudes in general kinematics and at finite coupling. But for the time being, this is no longer the case. However, we have a very good handle, which is the collinear limit. This is described by a different set of variables, how they, this is the explicit form on how they depend on the cross ratios, but it won't be very important in what follows. And also for the purposes of studying this limit, it will be more convenient to think about a different normalization of the amplitude, but it's trivial how to go from one to the other. So this is also immaterial how we describe it to this guy, how we decide to describe to normalize the amplitude. And the point is that in this limit, it's possible to show that the amplitude or the Wilson loop has a universal structure that just, is dictated by the conformal symmetry that does not quite depend on the theory. It can be thought, in this limit, you can think of this polygon as squashing into a square, into the square in the middle, OPSF. Then this square can be thought as a quark-antiquark pair, similarly to how the static quark-antiquark potential has appeared in the study of Wilson loops. The details of this I won't have time to go through, but we can then think about the departure from the collinear limit as different excitations of the flux tube that is spanned by this quark-antiquark pair. And so this bit over here precisely is governed by the propagation of these excitations. And then something happens also when the excitations move on from one square to the other of this polygon. So this is the so-called Wilson loop operator products expansion that was introduced in this very, very interesting paper. And as I said, it's for general theories. And then particularly for n equals 4, we can map these excitations to an integrable SL2R spin chain or equivalent to the GKP string. And this allows us to completely determine all the quantities that appear in this expansion. Initially, Benjamin on his own computed the energy or the dispersion relation. And then together with Amit and Pedro, they completed this description and also included these pentagon transitions. And this was my personal also entry in the world of amplitudes. I was very much intrigued by this connection, and I started working on it in 2013, along with many others. And so this will be our starting point, the collinear limit. The problem, though, where we understand integrability, as I mentioned, we have all the building blocks there. So the collinear limit is depicted here. It's this triangle in the space of cross ratios, and we really want to go here in the middle. So unfortunately, at first instance, these two limits do not seem to intersect. It's not as trivial as one would like. Nevertheless, they are related by the three edges of this cube, which is the so-called double scaling limit. This is a limit that was initially studied by Benjamin, Amit, and Pedro, and also by myself and James Drummond. And the good news is that this limit only a subset of all the different excitations of the flux tube contribute. In particular, the simplest or so-called gluon excitations of the flux tube contribute. So this is the particle number. Excitations have a fixed particle number, and this is similar to the previous formula I quoted. It's just that they have a continuous spectrum, and so we are integrating over. And the limit is the origin is when we take the difference of this phi and tau kinematic variables to infinity. So unfortunately, we have this summing presentation. It's good at finite coupling, but it's outside the radius of convergence of the sum. It's possible to perturbatively resum this expression, and this is what we did with James, at least for one particle. It's possible to do it also for higher particles, but this is much harder. Nevertheless, as we'll see, it's not really necessary. And that's what that was one of the breakthroughs and one of the important understandings that we achieved. And in particular, even though I won't talk in detail about Reggie theory, there was one aspect of Reggie theory that was very, very important for us. And this was to do an analytic continuation in this sum, in this integer variable that is in fact the helicity of the excitation, and replace it with an integral, simply by thinking about doing a contour integral encircling all the poles of this integrand. And this is valid as long as the integrand is sufficiently well behaved at infinity. And once you go through this analytic continuation, then you can check the dependence also on A, on this initial integer helicity. And you can see that you can, without problem, deform your original contour to go parallel to the imaginary axis. And in fact, the origin limit, where phi is very large, just amounts then to closing this contour in the other direction and encircling just the pole at A equals zero. So this is really all it takes. We have, again, the OPE integrand, the OPE building blocks, but all we have is a modified contour of integration. So that was the crucial step in our understanding. And after further massaging the integral and some experimentation and also the weak coupling results that we had at our disposal, we were led to the following finite coupling conjecture.
Sorry, so you have one more minute.
Just. Okay, so this is the main result in any case. So if you were, yes, now it's time to focus. If you had zoomed out, this is the main results that we achieved in this paper. So we wrote down, we understood that we can write down the six particle MHV amplitude in the origin limit in this form. For the moment, this is precisely telling us about the exponentiated double logarithm, so nothing about these quantities yet. but you noticed I have put some numbers here. And in fact, the point is that we can define some anomalous dimensions that depend on a single continuous parameter in precisely the same way that the cusp anomalous dimension is defined. And the building block that enters in this definition is a modified or tilted Beisert-Edenstau-Dacher kernel, precisely by this single variable alpha. Obviously, it coincides with the usual BS kernel where alpha is 45 degrees, but it gives different values different values of alpha. And here, this is just a reshuffling of the BES kernel, where we took the odd even indices and grouped them in different way and multiplied them also with different sines and cosines. This is, again, the particular expression for the BES kernel. And I should say that apart from the anomalous dimension, also the constant over here is similarly expressible as a log det of this tilted BS kernel. So that was our finite coupling conjecture that we tested in various ways. First of all, we plotted the one appearing in the four-point correlator corresponds to angle zero. As I said, the gamma cusp corresponds to pi fourth, and the new anomalous dimension discovered corresponds to pi cubed. And the dots are just numerics, and then the lines have to do with strong and weak coupling expansions, similarly also for the determinant. And we were also able to analyze our formulas at strong coupling and do the expansions over there analytically, as I mentioned. And we could compare with the Aldai-Maldacena approach to scattering amplitudes as minimal surfaces of strings ending on the boundary of the ABS space in this contour dictated by the kinematics. Particularly in the case where the cross ratios were going to zero at equal pace, there was this beautiful result by Aldai, Gaiolto, Maldacena, also supplemented with some constants. We were able to precisely match this. And we could could also match at strong coupling the second anomalous dimension that appeared in our setup. I will not have time to talk about, unfortunately, the high energy limit.
You have minus 3 minutes already, so.
Okay, I conclude.
Come to the conclusion, please.
Yeah. I go straight to the conclusions. The multi-regi limit, the same ingredients also hold, and one starts from the OPE and can describe amplitudes at any number of legs. Hopefully, I'll be able to talk about it more in the discussion. And there is also interesting work for higher particle amplitudes having to do with understanding their singularities. And together with my student and simultaneously with other two groups, we were able to propose a finite set of singularities for 8 particle amplitudes. So now I jump to my conclusions. I hope I convinced you about the beauty and simplicity of amplitudes and equals for Super Young-Mills theory. And the main punchline was in the sea of general kinematics, in particular the 6-particle amplitude, I showed you another island, the so-called origin limit, where you can describe it at finite coupling. In fact, I also told you how to get there, at least briefly, from the OPE, which is this corner over here, this island. And if I had more time, I would also tell you how to go to this island over here, which is the multi-regi limit. But in any case, there are many, many interesting future directions. And I come back to my original question, can the integrability of planar n equals 4 together with the analytic structure allow us to construct the exactest matrix of the theory? Thank you very much for your attention.
Great. Thank you, Yorgos. Let's thank Yorgos. And Now we can take a few questions. You can raise your hand or unmute. Juan, please.
Yeah, so gamma CASP can be interpreted as some limit of a Wilson loop, right, with a CASP. Does this parameter alpha have some geometric interpretation like this, as some deformation of the Wilson loop and maybe taking...
This is an excellent question. And you see, it's also here in my conclusions slide. It would be very, very interesting to understand what is the physical interpretation, what it corresponds physically. Yes, this kind of tilt angle. Certainly, the CASP anomalous dimension has to do with light-like CASP. So everything is on the light cone. Normally, there is no other variable left. And I have discussed also with Tobias Huber, where they discussed the more general, CASP anomalous dimension. Also, at weak coupling, following, I guess, from your work with Amit and others, Juan. The first instance, there didn't seem to be any relation of those angles with our alpha.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, we have a question from Amit.
A bit more technical. If I understood correctly, you arrived at this limit starting from the limit that selects the gluons, right?
Yes, the double scaling limit, exactly.
Well, this limit only works perturbatively. It doesn't work non-perturbatively. So how you got?
Yes, indeed, you are right. It doesn't make sense to consider this limit at strong coupling.
Not just strong coupling, but at finite coupling.
At finite coupling? No, I mean, if you are close to the...
Because the energy of the gluons get corrections. And it doesn't cancel the charge.
Yes, but okay, if the coupling is not strong, if it's relatively weak, it's still close to the classical value, I guess.
Okay, we can discuss.
Of course, we were motivated when we started looking at precise perturbative data that we had at our disposal. As far as the contour prescription I described, you saw that it makes no particular reference to the coupling. What was important was essentially that phi, the variable phi, goes to infinity. Perhaps this is the most important aspect, that phi goes to infinity. And part of this may hold even for, well, yes, the contour deformation, yes, should hold also outside of the origin limit, should be valid for the general double scaling limit.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, maybe one last question. Okay, if there are no more questions, let's thank Yorgos again and move on to the next speaker. Our next speaker is Amit Server from Tel Aviv. He's going to tell us about an